I'm going to talk about genomics as a tool to study clownfishes. So, as everybody presented, biodiversity is important, but in my case specific, I find clownfish really special. Why this? First of all, clownfish live in sea anemones. This is something that we call mutualistic interaction, so it means that both of the partners, so clownfishes and sea anemones, actually benefits from the interaction. So how the clownfish benefits from the interaction is kind of straightforward. Sea anemones are toxic, so when they see, when clownfish are inside sea anemones, they are just protected from predators. On the other hand, clownfish also protect sea anemones from predation, and also by swimming around, it allows oxygenation of the sea anemones, so it helps it breathing. And clownfish excrete ammonia, sulfur, and phosphorus that is also used by the sea anemones as a nutrient. So this interesting association actually lead to other interesting characteristic of clownfish. So they really live long, so they can live up to 30 years, that is the double of other fish of the same family. And they have complex social structure and sequential hermaphroditism, which means that they change sex during lifetime. So for this, it can be illustrated here. We have the social structure in a sea anemone. The biggest individual is the female, the second largest is the male, and then we can have juveniles inside the sea anemone. What happens when the female dies is actually that the male becomes a female, and then the largest juvenile here becomes the male. So, additional to this, clownfish adapted to different sea anemones, and this allowed them to rapidly diversify. So here you can see, I don't know if you can actually see, but clownfish interact with actually 10 different species of sea anemones. So this really led to, it was presented geographical isolation for speciation, but this kind of habitat is actually also making us think that ecology actually plays a role. So if we can make a scheme of what happened, we have an ancestral species of clownfish that couldn't interact with the anemone. At one point in the past, we had an acquisition of a trait that allowed the interaction with the anemone. So the fish enter the sea anemones and find a free and new habitat where there were no predators, so it could actually go around and find other places and choose the best. And so it was before illustrated like ecological divergence, so two different populations that got adapted to different type of sea anemones, and then with time they diverge, and they keep on diverging because the habitat is still free, until we get to the diversity that we see today with different clownfishes that are morphologically different, and this morphology is correlated with the type of sea anemones with who they are associated. So, for us, clownfish are special, but our question is how did they became special? So we want to know which mechanism allowed clownfish to adapt to sea anemone and diversify. So our strategy is to go to the genes level, so we have to investigate genomes. So as you all probably know, all organisms has DNA in which we have genes that code for a certain phenotype or a characteristic of an individual. For example, here we can have this gene that is responsible for the color of the fish. If at one point there is a mutation, for example here, A to C, the behavior of the gene change and it can make the clownfish or change the phenotype, for example here becoming black. So our aim is really to link the gene sequence with the phenotype. But for this we need the gene sequence to compare. So for this reason we do genomics of the clownfish. So we take a fin clips of the fish, we extract DNA, we sequence, and then we, after a lot of bioinformatics and we got a really long sequence of nucleotides, so A, T, C, and G. And from this, we really got the whole genome, and we can predict all the future of a genome. And in this case, we are really interested in the gene or protein sequences. So if we got the sequence, now we can investigate them. So we have our clownfishes with the ecology and where they live, and we got the gene sequences and the relationship that we have between them. And what we are really interested really in a oversimplified way is to find changes that are really linked to the phenotype or with the adaptation that they have. For example, here we could have that this GA is really linked to the adaptation to the pink sea anemones, while AA, it could be linked to the adaptation to another sea anemones. We can also, here in this example, we are really having a look at how they diversify from a genetic point of view. But we can also ask ourselves how they actually got to interact with the anemone at the first place. So with the same method, we can get sequence from outgroups of fishes that are not interacting with the anemones and get sequencing for them. And again, compare and try to find some genes that have a signature where we have a conservation in all fishes, but not clownfishes, and something different that is really common that could therefore be linked to the adaptation to sea anemones. So just to summarize, we want to answer the question of which mechanism allow clownfish to adapt to sea anemones and diversify. So we are obtaining genomic sequence and retrieving all genes in the genomes. And then the idea is to detect the sequence linked to a particular adaptation. And then once we have this gene with this characteristic, we can investigate their function and so get an insight from the mechanism. So just while we were in Maldives, I think there is already explained, but in addition, the three species that you have here, they're also interesting because they differ in the sea anemones host. So we could really study also for this diversification process. So I would like to thank, okay. I would like to thank everybody, Loic Pellissier and all his group, especially Julia and all Maldivian authorities and the university, and Nicola, my boss, and all this group that helped me. Okay, thank you.